Welcome, this is Information Service Engineering, lecture number 3, Natural Language Processing, part 2. Today, in this section of the lecture, we want to talk about NLP challenges. So, why is natural language so difficult? For this, I brought you Ferdinand de Saussure. So, this is a French linguist and philosopher, and his ideas laid the foundation of many significant developments for both linguistics as well as semiotics in the 20th century. So he's widely considered one of the founders of 20th century linguistics. Okay, why did I bring this guy to you? I let him say something. Of course, he probably never quoted exactly this thing in these words that you see here, but in his writings you will find exactly the reason why natural language is considered so difficult. Okay, let's have a look at our example. He says, I'm a linguist. I love language more than most people. You see exactly where the problem lies. So does this guy love language more than other people like language? Or does he simply hate people or most people? Okay, so what we are talking about here is ambiguity and also paraphrasing. So the way to express things in different, you know, words. And ambiguity means that the same words or the same sentence can have multiple meanings. So these two things, paraphrasing and ambiguity, are responsible for most of the difficulties we have in language. And this does not only refer on single words, but also refers on larger structures. And the resolution to find out what is really the meaning of a longer set of characters is therefore much more difficult. And completely different from formal languages like, for example, that you have in computer science or mathematics. Okay, let's first have a look at paraphrasing. So what's a paraphrase? A paraphrase is a restatement of the meaning of a text or passage simply by using other kind of words. And this comes from Greek, like most of these expressions here in linguistics. Paraphrasis means additional manner of expression of something. Let's have a few examples. Google bought YouTube, or you can say Google acquired YouTube. So here you only used another verb with more or less the same meaning. When will my book arrive? When will I receive my book? Both of the sentences also mean more or less the same. However, at the first sentence, the book is the subject, and the second sentence, me, I am the subject. Next example, Pat said, I like football, or Pat said that he liked football. So you see direct speech, indirect speech, also two ways to express exactly the same. Pat likes Chris because she's smart. Or you can say Pat likes Chris because Chris is smart. So here one you use a pronoun, and on the other hand you use the name of the guy you think he's smart. Okay. This means we have many, many ways to express exactly the same subject. Let's switch to the other side, ambiguity. Ambiguity is vice versa. There you have one word or one sentence which can have different meanings, of course, in the language to which it belongs to. Let's have a look at a few examples. We start with plant. Plant is only a single word. So by simply using plant, it can have several meanings. What might be the meanings? You can see from its surroundings how it is used. If you have the words workers at a plant, then suddenly plant becomes a specific meaning. Like you could also say plant a garden, then it suddenly becomes a verb. Or you can say plant meltdown. Or if you're using grace and plant in the same sentence, okay, this also gives a hint of what it might mean. Houseplant, CIA plant, or plant firmly on the ground. So you see the same word or the same letters, but different meanings. The door is open. There the ambiguity is already on a higher level, because it can also literally mean, of course, that the door is open, but also, you know, that a way now suddenly opens up for you and you have to decide to take it. We saw her duck. Ah, that's also a rather popular and prominent example. So either she's ducking or we see her dog, the bird. Kids make nutritious snacks. I really like that. So this depends on, you know, how you structure the sentence what's the meaning of the sentence. Of course, we know by experience that, of course, it's not the kids that are nutritious snacks. So it means kids can make nutritious snacks. It knows you like your mother. I could pronounce it in a different way. I could say, it knows you like your mother. So you see, also, depending on where I put the emphasis while speaking, the interpretation is completely different. So this makes it much more difficult than if you only read the sentence to really understand it in the correct way. So let's have a more, let's say, organized approach to ambiguity. Where can we find ambiguity? On which level? What can we decide there? So we start first with a phonological ambiguity. So this means we have here words which sound exactly the same or more or less the same, but have different meanings. For example, weekend and weekend. They sound more or less the same. So it's like with there and there, or here and here. You see it here, there's a website collecting exactly these phonological ambiguities for English language. You might have a look, so it's sometimes really funny. Besides phonological ambiguities, let's go one step further. We go now to text. We have so-called lexical ambiguities. And among there, we distinguish between polysemy. This is lexical ambiguity in itself. This is one word of a specific category. So the word is either a noun or a verb. And this word can have several meanings, which is determined, of course, by the context called lexical sense. We know already the example jaguar. And a jaguar, of course, this is a noun. Interpreted as a noun, it can mean you refer to the car, to the cat, to the operating system, or something else, which is also called jaguar. On the other end, we have homonymy. What is that? There you have different words that are spelled and pronounced exactly the same way, like a book as a noun or to book as a verb. So the difference is in polysemy, it's word of the same category. So you're always looking on nouns or you're always looking on verbs. In homonymy, these words are of different category. Very nice example here. For example, time flies like an arrow, fruit flies like banana. You see here, one's verb, one's noun. So these are lexical ambiguities. And they usually refer on a single word. Let's go one step further. Now we are looking at sentences, and then we come to so-called syntactic ambiguities. In syntactic ambiguities, so we have there a situation where a sentence may be interpreted in more than one way due to ambiguous sentence structure. So why am I showing you here two people back from the Second World War sitting over the rooftops of London looking for an air raid? Simply because this picture fits quite well to my following example. So these kind of syntactic ambiguities are also called amphiboly or amphibology. And the example is the following. He saw a man on the rooftop with a binocular. So let's think a while about it. So where is here the ambiguity? Okay, on the one hand, this could mean he saw the man on the rooftop with a binocular, which means I'm looking through a binocular, seeing a man on the rooftop on the next house. Or it could mean he saw the man on the rooftop with a binocular, meaning the man holds the binocular. So like the guys here sitting on the rooftop. So to make these things even more complex, also the man on the rooftop could be distinguished. The man on the rooftop might be, I see a man who is sitting on the rooftop, or I'm on the rooftop if I say he saw the man on a rooftop, so while he was sitting on the rooftop. So this could also be meant by exactly that sentence, although it's less likely. But you see, the point is, if you do a syntactic parsing, so a constituency parsing, to see, you know, what belongs together, so what is a verb phrase, what is a noun phrase, you can order these single subtrees in your parse tree in a different way. And this then determines the meaning, as you see here, because it's not clear in which way or in which sequence I should interpret here the single parts of the sentence. And this comes then up with ambiguity. Another rather famous example of syntactic ambiguity here is Groucho Marx. I don't know if you students still know Groucho Marx as part of the Marx Brothers. So he was a famous comedian in the 1930s, 40s, and so on. And in one of his movies, Animal Crackers from 1930, he is Captain Spaulding, and he should give a speech about his experiences and his adventures in Africa. And while telling that, he says, "One morning I shot an elephant in my pajamas. How he got into my pajamas, I'll never know." So you see, again, famous syntactic ambiguity, but they can also be rather short or even shorter. For example, "Get the cat with the gloves." So is the cat wearing the gloves, or do I have to wear the gloves to get the cat? Or our previous example, "Kids make nutritious snacks." You can also here use syntactic ambiguity to get or to achieve several interpretations. Again, one step further, we have so-called semantic ambiguities, and they depend also on the meaning of a single word, but then determine the meaning of an entire larger structure of a sentence. So you have here a situation where a sentence contains one or more words with different meanings, and the significance of the sentence changes dramatically depending on which meaning, of course, is intended. Let's have an example here again. "The astronomer loves the star." Usually you would think of, okay, it's an astronomer, of course, if he's looking at the starry night, then of course he might love a specific star more than other stars there. However, it could also mean that the astronomer has fallen in love with a movie star. And of course, thereby, star having two different meanings, the meaning of the entire sentence might change dramatically. Let's go further. Referential ambiguities. So here, for example, what we do here is coreference analysis. And thereby, you have here an analysis of coherent sequences of sentences. And subclauses or subsequent clauses might refer to different entities of the first sentence. So this is a so-called referential ambiguity. Simple example, Alice understands that you like your mother, but she is blah, 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 blah. And then the question is, she might refer either to Alice, but also might refer to mother. So this is a referential ambiguity. So natural language is always highly ambiguous. This means it's context sensitive. Depending on the context, you might interpret the stuff differently. For example, one context might be, "To whom are you telling this?" So it depends on the people present. For example, if I ask, "How far is it?" And if I'm asking this here, let's say in continental Europe, the distance will be given in kilometers. If I ask this, for example, in the US, then the distance for sure will be given in miles or other kind of imperial units. It also depends on the social context. If I ask or say, "That was expensive," of course, you have to know, you know, whether I'm a rich guy or whether I'm quite poor to estimate what means expensive for me. It also depends on the location of the one who is uttering exactly this sentence. So if I say, "Play a specific song upstairs," to know in which, you know, floor it should be played, you have to know exactly your location, whether you are now in the second or in the third floor, to know whether I should play it then in the third or the fourth floor. So location dependency. And if it's dependent from the on the location, then it might also be dependent on time. So the time of day, for example. If I say, "Let's go eat," yeah, depending on the time of day, it's either breakfast, lunch, or dinner. So this can be completely different. It also can depend on, you know, what you have said before. So it depends on prior sentences. If I say the third one I was just mentioning, or the third one of the things I was just mentioning, you have to know what was the sentence before to know what the third one really means. And in addition, it's even more difficult and to detect and correctly interpret if you're speaking slang or any kind of jargon, or if you're, yeah, you know, trying to make a humorous sentence or using sarcasm. So sarcasm detection is really, really, let's say, the high art of natural language processing. And of course, you also have to consider that people are making spelling mistakes or grammar mistakes, or they newly create words and abbreviations. And of course, all of this has to be resolved. And this makes language, of course, difficult. And there is an additional step that might be considered, because we know what is understanding depending on. So we have syntax, we might have syntactic ambiguities, we have semantics, there might be semantic ambiguities. We have now looked already on the context, and we also have to take into account the pragmatics of the speaker, especially, for example, for humor or sarcasm. Third one might be experience. So common sense knowledge is also really important to resolve ambiguities. So why is NLP really, really, really hard? I want to introduce you to something which is called the Vinograd Schema Challenge. So the Vinograd Schema Challenge is a showcase, and that shows us the necessity to combine linguistics with common sense or world knowledge to really understand the semantics of natural language. So the Vinograd Schema Challenge, this is a test of machine intelligence, has been proposed by a guy named Hector Levesque, and he's a computer scientist at the University of Toronto. What is it? So it's designed to be an improvement of the famous Turing test. You have heard of the Turing test? So this is a question answer test where you try to find out whether the guy you are questioning is a computer or a human being. And the Vinograd Challenge test is usually a multiple choice test that employs questions of a very specific structure. This is the so-called Vinograd Schema. And Vinograd Schema are named after Terry Vinograd, so professor of computer science at Stanford University. And on the surface, what they require, Vinograd Schema questions, they require simply the, let's say, the resolution of a coreference ambiguity. So let's here have a look at an example. The trophy doesn't fit into the brown suitcase because it's too, is it small or large? Now, depending on how you resolve this coreference, you have to use small if it refers to the suitcase, or you have to refer to large if it refers to the trophy. So you see, to resolve this, you have to know a bit about the world, which means you have to know what is a trophy, what is a suitcase. So first of all, you have to do the so-called anaphora or coreference revolution. So on which of the previous entities does the pronoun refer to? And then you have to know that, of course, a smaller object can fit into a larger one, but not vice versa. And you have to know that a suitcase cannot fit into a trophy. So this all is common sense knowledge. This is world knowledge that you know by experience. And you can only do a correct resolution of this kind of ambiguity if you know these things. So they are really hard. How can a machine learn these things? So we know, we humans, we know this because we learn from experience. So we will see a suitcase, we will know what to pack into a suitcase, and of course we can't pack things into a suitcase that are larger than a suitcase. So we will learn this by our experience. So for a machine, either I have to do a hard encoding of exactly this kind of rules, but of course then for any special situation, I might require different kind of rules. So this of course is overwhelming to have all these rules really available. Or I might learn also by experience, let's say from existing language resources. So I look at large document corpora, for example, on the web, and I try to resolve this via statistics with statistical learning, which means, what occurs more frequently, if I look at the co-occurrence, let's say, of things and suitcases to see what is inside what. So I can learn this from simply by reading it often enough. So then I will simply see, okay, the things that have been packed into a suitcase usually then are smaller than the suitcase. Of course, this is difficult to learn and you need large amounts of language resources for that, but it's possible because in the Vinograd Schema Challenge, current large language models, and these are of course statistical language models, They do quite well. You can see this, you can simply Google it. Okay, but what does it mean doing quite well? We have, of course, to quantify the output of an experiment like that. And to do that, in the next lecture, we will talk about evaluation, precision, and recall as means to quantify the results and the outcome of an experiment.